This morning, my friends, we are very motivated that we have so many of you here present in Aruba. And we are very motivated because over the course of the history of Aruba, and we have seen many of the same challenges and still see many of the same challenges that you see in your countries. Many of the challenges are challenges that we can confront with the resources that we have as a public sector. Many of our countries, even our most poorest countries among us, have built our own hospitals, have built our own schools, have built our own infrastructures. But many of us have also faced the moment in where there is a big difference in the development of what we call the developed countries and the countries that are still in development. And as we make the comparison, it is logic that our countries and our people also desire to have those more developed infrastructures, those more developed and sustainable tourism entities, the more sustainable infrastructures for our schools, for our hospitals, for our elderly care. In Aruba, I very often say, when we analyze the impact that the tourism development had in Aruba, and some years ago we saw that our development in the other areas did not keep pace with the development of our hotel industry, we said we would also like to have not only five-star hotels in Aruba, but also five-star schools, five-star elderly homes, five-star neighborhoods. So we start working on ways in order to make this possible, even with limited budget. And we very fast found out that if we work together with the private sector, we can be creative in the ways that we can realize this development also for our people, even though we have to work with limited budgets. So today, for us, it is a great moment, and a great moment, I believe, for all of you, to have the opportunity to share in some of our experience, but share mostly in the experience and knowledge that all the presentators that we'll be having here today can learn us and teach us and guide us in making these dreams possible for even small countries with very little budgets. Coming together as private and public sector is something that the UN has been encouraging over the last decades. But in reality, if we look at the development, we can see that recently, with all the global challenges around the world, it has become more evident also to the private sector that they cannot only focus on making gains for the shareholders, but it's also about the shared responsibility towards the future and the global challenges. Because when islands will be overflowed by water or natural disaster hits, it doesn't make a distinction between the public sector and the private sector. It's not only schools that are devastated by a hurricane, it's also commercial buildings and infrastructure that is so necessary, like harbors and airports, for the private sector. So the private sector has also become more aware that there doesn't exist a solely responsibility of the public sector to take care of the common good of societies. That the common good, as the word says, it's common good. That means that both the public sector as the private sector have to work together in order for us to be able to realize a better quality of life for everyone, in where our society has the opportunity to thrive and also the business sector has an opportunity to thrive. In the case of Aruba itself, we have had a development that for many of you is maybe new, and I don't know where the pictures will be showing today. Yes, thank you. First, let me introduce you to this tree. We're very proud that in Aruba, in all the droughts and the arid grounds, we have maybe the most powerful symbol of sustainability. Because Aruba is so dry, and it's very hard for vegetation to prosper on a very dry island, we have a very particular tree we call the Dividivi, or the Watapana, or the Fototi. We have given through history different names to it. And this tree has a particular message for us, because despite the drought, this tree grows and withstands all the harsh conditions of nature. And it does so because it grows with the direction of the hard wind, northeastern wind that Aruba has. So working with the forces of nature, and for some of us, more religiously among us, working with the forces of our Creator, we learn how to survive. That is the best teaching for what means sustainability, is working with the forces of nature. Aruba, in the beginning of the last century, had a development that was so eloquently presented in the opening of Mrs. Waver, where the society celebrated a interesting slow development, which was like part of growth combined with all the values of society pretty well in balance. And people enjoyed in the 40s and 50s the development, people embraced it, and it was not menacing, it was change that really happened at a pace that we could follow and that was not threatening. We also had the opening of an oil refinery that brought many people from other islands to Aruba, so we created a very interesting multicultural society in Aruba, which really is the foundation of our society today. And as the refinery went through its first phase of automatization in 1950s, we had very creative leaders that immediately saw the potential of the beautiful beaches of Aruba and decided to confront the challenges of the automatization of the refinery and the unemployment that we were facing at that moment with the beginning of the touristic industry in Aruba. So we start building our first hotel. Then in the 1980s, that refinery did not further follow the automatization process, but at the end closed, and we had suddenly a unemployment of more than 40%, and the government lost 50% of its revenue, and Aruba was facing an enormous crisis. Yesterday, I was sharing with the Undersecretary that for many countries in the islands, natural disaster is the reason that suddenly they can start from zero again. In the case of Aruba, we have been spared a lot of those natural disasters, but we had economic disasters where one economic pillar, like a refinery that represents 50% of your GDP, suddenly closes, and then you have a dramatic effect as if when a natural disaster occurs on one of our islands. So Aruba faced at that moment an enormous challenge, and so we decided to tap in again in what we were strong in and what was a dormant potential for Aruba, and that was the fast expansion of our tourism industry. And we went from 2,000 hotel rooms to more than 8,000 hotel rooms in a few years, from 200,000 tourists, then more than 1 million arriving via our airports, and almost 700,000 arriving with cruise ships during 1 year in Aruba. So our island changed very fast. We went from 40% unemployment to full employment, from 60,000 people to 100,000 people, 40,000 people immigrated to Aruba, because we did not only create sufficient jobs for our own people, we also created jobs for people in the region to immigrate to Aruba. So when we look at large countries nowadays and seeing their feeling of insecurity with immigration, we say, look at some of our islands, how we have embraced immigration, how an island of 60,000 people born on the island grew to 100,000 in less than 10 years, and we were still able to assimilate, and from foreigners became friends, and from friends became all co-citizens on one small island. So if we talk about lessons that can be learned from islands, maybe we can start with that lesson of multiculturalism. How, if you have the right approach, if you have the right leadership that does not encourage fear, but encourage people to look at one another and see if you can learn something from a new friend, leadership that sees the potential of diversification in culture and habits, in history, how you can utilize that as part of your own progress, then it is indeed possible to create a society where people are from different religion, are from different countries, all living on the same soil and creating a common future. So one of the first things maybe when we talk about global challenges, we talk about insecurity in the world and how we can bring communities together, maybe it's worth a study on how islands do this. I won't know the formula either. It almost happens naturally, organically on our islands, but it might be worth a study of seeing how such a dramatic number of immigrants can come on a very small island and people are still able to assimilate and embrace each other over time and become one nation. Through the course of the years, with the development of our hotel industry, we reached a point where all the calculations and we had also with our statistics proved to us in the year 2000 was exactly the tipping point that a further expansion of our economy purely based on expanding our tourism industry would not have a added value for the well-being of our society. If what you are looking for is not only GDP growth, but also well-being and socio-economic progress for your societies, it is very important to measure very well where the GDP relates to the well-being of your citizens. Because economic growth does not always, and especially not in our experience in a touristic economy, always translates into better quality of life for your citizens. And that's something that governments should really follow closely to assure that the right instruments are put in place, that the right policies are applied in order to translate that economic growth, that prosperity, that very encouraging GDP growth number into well-being for your citizens. And that is something we discovered in Aruba when we decided around the year 2007 and 8, when there was a world crisis. My colleague Sivinger and I and many of our other colleagues were still in parliament. We looked at the economic development of Aruba and we felt that we needed to have new solutions for not only the crisis but also for the translation of economic growth into well-being for our society. So we decided that we needed to find a sustainable policy for the future economic and social development of Aruba. And based on that thinking and reflection, together with the community, we came up with a vision that we call sustainable and shared prosperity. We call it sustainable because it has to be able to be carried by a very small island and a very small population. We call it shared because it needs to be shared so that we have an equitable distribution of the income in our society. As I mentioned before, it is important not only to have five-star hotels, but also five-star schools, five-star public spaces, five-star quality of life for our citizens. So we set as our priority to find a social economic model where we can translate economic prosperity and well-being for our society. That means nicer schools for our people. That means better communities, better neighborhoods where there are no pavement to bring pavement, where there are no light, there's no bring light, where there are no connectivity or connection to bring connection, where people are living under the income and the basic line, give the additional allowance so people can have a decent income to create a happy well-being for the citizen. So we started also at the moment of the economic crisis to invest in order not only to create a stronger product which would not concentrate on volume but would concentrate on quality. We focus very much on investment in our city renewal projects, in our neighborhood renewal projects, in our school projects, in our infrastructure. And we did all this, and I will just show you some pictures, renovating and restoring old buildings, restoring buildings that were abandoned, building stadiums, restoring and revitalizing old main streets that were abandoned, bring back a connection between society and the identity of our community. We just had the presentation of Mrs. Waver here. We are that part of history of how proud people were of the development had a lot to do with the identification of progress with the society. Whenever progress leaves the society behind, it's not experienced as progress anymore by the society. So it's very important that the symbols that form part of your identity are not left behind. So if it's your monument, or it's your main street, or it's your old neighborhood, it's very important that in the development that we plan, we keep that link between our identity, our commitment to our society, and the progress that we are aspiring. And so that's what we have been focused on in Aruba. And we have done that in collaboration with the private sector in Aruba. In the course of these days, I hope that you will get an opportunity to also see our different projects that we have been developing on the PPP concept. Our Minister of Infrastructure will talk about them, four-way lanes, new hospital, new container harbor, solar parks, windmill parks. All of these projects have been developed on the PPP concept, and it's only by bringing together the vision of the public sector, where we want to go as a nation, combined with that commitment that it will be sustainable and it will be shared among the society in an equitable way, and bringing in the private sector that has the financial resources and has the human resources also in a lot of cases, that only in that way for many countries, but specifically islands, it is possible to reach the dream to have a sustainable and shared prosperity. And it is for that reason that we are very proud that Aruba has been chosen to host this conference. We would like to learn much more of where there's more opportunities in thinking of ways to bring the private sector and the public sector together. And we definitely hope to hear from our other island nations how CITS can prosper with this PPP model in order for us also to guarantee not only economic development for our society, but also a good quality of life for everyone. As we started this morning, we understand more than ever again, maybe this morning after what we have just experienced in Brussels, that a lot of the problems in the world have to do with the feeling of insecurity, maybe some feeling of unfairness in the way history has gone, the way the cards maybe have been dealt through history. And it is our responsibility to see how we can build bridges in order to create more understanding among people that don't understand each other, and build these bridges also towards the future in order to have a better life for everyone in this world. So thank you very much, and I hope that we can share the experience of Aruba with you, but also that you can share your experience with us, and that the UN and the Department of Foreign Affairs of the Netherlands were so helpful. Karel, thank you very, very much for your support. Since Karel has being the ambassador for the Kingdom of the Netherlands in the UN, I must say the islands, the Dutch Caribbean, but all islands are getting a lot of attention. Qatar has, and I think the Department of Foreign Affairs, a very special place for islands in their hearts and understand the challenges of islands. So together with this partnership with the UN, the Department of Foreign Affairs, I hope that we can deliver next week, hopefully also together with the UNDP, we'll open the Center of Excellence in Aruba, where we will bring together all the knowledge in the area of sustainability, both in the area of energy, but also socioeconomic aspects of sustainability, sponsored by Richard, thank you very, very much, by the UNDP in Aruba. Again, a beautiful recognition for Aruba that the Center of Excellence is established in Aruba, and it is a center of excellence not just for Aruba, it's in Aruba, but it will accumulate all the information and knowledge around the world on how to create sustainable societies in all areas and make it available to the rest of the world. So as a small island, we are very happy that we can also contribute to bringing solutions to global challenges. Thank you very much.